Well, what's up, that church? How's everybody? Man, I am glad to see y'all. Glad those of you join us online. We're glad that you're with us too. How cool it is to be here on the Lord's Day and figuring some stuff out. You know, it's kind of funny, just backstage, just before I came out, I was talking to Jessica and she said, you know, this message couldn't come at a better time. We're going to be dealing with discouragement. You know, I would say this too. Have you seen and noticed that there's a lot of discouragement around us right now? Have you seen that? Have you seen a lot of people just really, and it's not any one particular thing. It's not like we can pinpoint it and say, well, this is kind of the source of the discouragement that a lot of people are experiencing. It's just, it's coming from a lot of directions. I would dare say that some of you in this room just this very week are having to process and deal with and kind of go through some discouraging moments in your own life. And we all face that. It doesn't matter how long you've been a Christian. It doesn't matter, you know, how super spiritual you might think that you are. At some point in your life, you're going to face discouragement. You're going to face just being down. You're going to face some junk, you know. Every once in a while, you'll run into somebody. You guys know what I'm talking about. One of those super duper really happy Christians that are happy all the time. Y'all know those people that you like, you know, some of the time? You know what I mean? That you just kind of get to the point where you just sometimes look at them and you go, are you on drugs? Because nobody can be that happy all the time. How do you do that? Some people, maybe they're just better at masking it. But the reality is we all face stuff. We face some junk. I mean, sometimes circumstances don't turn out like we thought. Maybe we worked really hard and the end result isn't exactly what we thought. Or maybe just the grind of life has kind of brought you to a place where you're just a little funky, you know? You know, not funky in a good way, not like a dance, but more like a funeral. And so kind of that's where you are. Well, that's good. I'm glad, well, not good, but I'm glad that you're here though, because God's got a message for that today. And it's some stuff that I needed to hear. And I pray that in the same way that God kind of shared this with me, I'm going to get to share it with you and talk to you a little bit about what it means to be discouraged. How many of you have ever seen the it's too late face? Now, let me preface that by saying this. You ever talk to somebody and they've already got in their mind, it's too late? And you try to convince them that it's not, but they give you the it's too late face. You know what I'm talking about? It's something like this. They kind of go, tried that, been there, done that. It's not going to work. You know what I'm talking about? Your friend's a couple of days away from divorce, and you're trying to talk him or her into just, let's do one more step of counseling. Let's try to get some help. You know, let's go one more step. Maybe some medicine for you or him, whichever. Something, some kind of help, you know, and they just go, we've already tried it all. We've already run through that. We're done. It won't work. Or the dad who hasn't spoken to his son in years, and you go, really? Life's too short for that. Try again. And they give you, that's too late. We've already tried it. It's not going to work. Or maybe you're weeks, months, maybe years away from retirement, and the economy, you know, torpedoes your retirement, and somebody looks at you and says, hey, listen, can you go back to school and get another career and give it another try? And that look, no, it's too late. It's the too late look. Too late to save our marriage. Too late for me to reconcile that relationship. Too late for a new career. Too late. We've seen it. You've even put that face off. You've given people that look, especially the super happy Christian comes in your life and telling you, hey, let's try again. And you go, ah, it's too late. You've done it. You've experienced it. That's where Peter is. This guy in the story that we're going to look at, he's at the too late point. And he's going to give none other than Jesus himself the look. He's going to give him the, it's too late. We've already tried, thanks, but no thanks kind of look. That's what's about to happen. It's too late to catch fish. And if you've got your outline, you can pull it out. In Luke chapter 5, we're going to look at it. It'll be on the screen. You also can pull it up on our app if you have the thatchurch.com app, or you can go to YouVersion Bible app, and our notes are there as well, and you can kind of keep track of those and email those notes back to yourself. But if you just want to go the hardcore, you know, old school, write it down on a piece of paper thing, we should have given you one at the door. And if we didn't, write it on your skin. It'll be worth it. In Luke chapter 5, verse 1, here's what the Bible says. One day as Jesus was preaching on the shores of the Sea of Galilee, great crowds pressed in on him to listen to God's word. So let me just give you the setting. They're at a place called the Sea of Galilee. The Sea of Galilee is, in fact, a 6 by 13 mile body of water. We wouldn't call it a sea, not here in Arkansas. We would call it a lake, because it's barely big enough really to water ski on. But that's what the Sea of Galilee is. Around the Sea of Galilee today, there's not some real hustle and bustle like there was in Jesus' day. In Jesus' day, there were several communities, and each of those communities had 15,000 or so people living in them. And evidently, according to this scripture, all of those people have poured out to come and see this message that's going to be taught by this pretty famous, at this point, rabbi, a guy named Jesus of Nazareth. He's trending. His Twitter account's blowing up. He's becoming famous, and so people kind of want to hear what he has to say. Verse 2 says this. He noticed, that's Jesus noticed, two empty boats at the water's edge, for fishermen had left them where they were washing their nets. Stepping into one of the boats, Jesus asked Simon, its owner, to push it out into the water. So he sat in the boat and taught the crowds from there. Now, you know, the casual reader of the Bible would go, okay, Jesus, there's too many people around him. And you know what it's like when you don't have a mic and too many people are too close. The people in the back can't hear. So Jesus said, to solve this, I'm going to get out in the water a little bit. And obviously people probably aren't going to swim out to me. They're going to stay on the bank. I'm going to get some distance. And then everybody, including the people in the back, are going to be able to hear what I'm talking about. That's in the casual reader, that's all you would see. But the person who understands that God's word is given to us in layers, and there's meaning beneath the meaning, beneath the meaning, beneath the meaning. If you're willing to excavate it like an archaeologist, God has a lot more to say in this. See, Jesus wants in Peter's boat because Peter's boat means a whole lot to Peter. You know what Peter does for a living? No, not a trick question. Yeah, he's a fisherman. That's right. If we were to introduce you to Peter and you're downtown in Galilee or whatever, we'd say, hey, this is Peter. He's a fisherman. That's what he does. Maybe he's got a little fishing coat on. Maybe he's got a little fillet knife on his hip or a pair of needle nose pliers to get hooks out or something. I don't know. But you would know that he's a fisherman. And to a fisherman, your boat means something to you, especially when you're talking about a fisherman that makes his living catching fish. He's not a casual part-time sport fisherman. This is a guy that makes his living off of catching fish, and that boat to Peter means a lot to him. So it's no accident that Jesus makes his way over to this arbitrary boat and hops over inside of it and gets in and says, hey, let's go out a little bit further and I'm going to teach from here. That's not an accident. Jesus does that on purpose because, see, this boat means something to Peter. Three things I think in particular this boat means to Peter. Three things that I think you ought to keep in mind. When God's ready to do something in your life, very often, God asks you to trust him with these same three things. See, this boat for Peter represented, first off, his identity. That's who he was, Peter, the fisherman. That's his identity. When people recognized Peter, they recognized him. Why? Because he was a fisherman. That's what he did. That was his trade. So this boat represents Peter's identity. The second thing that this boat represents is Peter's influence. Peter affected the crowd around him, affected the people around him. You know how he did it? As being a fisherman. Yeah, maybe he was the leader of the Sea of Galilee Fishing Society, or maybe he was, you know, part of the Trout's Unlimited, you know, maybe he was the president or something. But his influence for sure would have come through his trade. He's a fisherman. That's what he is. So his identity is caught up in this boat. His influence is caught up in this boat. But not only that, also his income. How did he make a living? He made a living by catching stinky little silvery, slimy little fish, and he would clean them and he would sell them to people, and they would take them home and make hush puppies and french fries and coleslaw and all kinds of good stuff. Is it new? It's got to be. That's what he did. That's how he made his living. So his income is tied up in that too. I want you to know something. When God's about to move in your life, I'm going to tell you something. He takes possession of certain things and he's going to use them. See, this boat was literally the platform that Peter stood on. It was where that's where his security was. His security was his income. His security was found in his identity. His security was found in his influence. And what does Jesus do? Jesus jumps right on that platform and says, hey, I want this platform. I want your identity. I want your influence. And you know what? You're going to have to give up some of your income. I want all three of those. But here's what I'll tell you, and this is something that if we were in a foot stomping church, there'd be some foot stomping going on what's about to happen right now. Here's what Jesus says is this. If you will give God the platform that you stand on, God will make it a pulpit where he will preach from. I'm going to say that again because you obviously didn't hear it and there's maybe an echo. If you will give God the platform that you stand on, God will make it the pulpit that he will preach from. You got me? That's right. That's what I like. See, there we go. You added 10 minutes to the message right there, just the enthusiasm. But here's the truth is this, is that God says, you know what? I don't want you trusting in your platform anymore. I want you trusting in me. And I'm going to take who you are and what you are, your influence, your identity, your income. I'm going to take you and I'm going to use you to change the world that you live in. And that's exactly what he does with Peter. I'll say this, if you give it up, God will fill it up. And that's exactly what Peter does. Peter says, I'm going to give it to you. And God says, I'm going to fill it up. And he does. This boat gets filled, and you'll see that here in just a second. So it goes on, and look at what verse 4 says. When he had finished speaking, so Jesus goes out to the deeper water, he teaches. He said to Simon, now go out where it's deeper, and then let down your nets. It's intriguing to me that Jesus says, hey, Peter, I don't want to stay in the shallow water because I want to do something in your life. For me to do something in your life, I want you to go to the deeper water. See, some of us came in this room today, and if you were to frame up a request for God, you could do it really easy today. You could easily go, God, here's what I need from you. Some of you would say, God, I need $100 extra a month. That's what I need from you. And you could frame that up real simple. God, here's what I need from you. I need better communication with my spouse. God, here's what I need from you. I need better friends that don't walk out on me. Some of you say, God, here's what I need from you. I need you to heal my broken heart. God, here's what I need from you. And you could easily frame up whatever it is that you need. Peter, if he knew what he was even needing, he could frame it up and say, Jesus, you know what I need? I need some fish. You know, we fished and didn't catch any, so I just simply need, and that's how he could frame it up. But very often, you and I come to God with a very shallow, superficial need. And what God wants to give us is something more than that shallow, superficial need. God says, hey, you know what? I could let you settle for a shallow faith, but I want to take you out to something deeper because I have something that's far more valuable than this little shallow thing that you're wanting. You know what churches do today? Very often, we as pastors, for a desire to meet you with your request and show you how God meets your needs, we've shallowed up the message of God. And there's plenty of churches that are a mile wide and an inch deep. But I want to say this. You should resist the desire for a faith that makes God this small, domesticated, little boxed-in animal. God's so much more than that. And what he wants for your life and what he wants to give you in your life and what he wants to show you in your life is so much more. See, Peter, he has this simple need. I just need some fish. But God says, I got more than that. And for me to give you what you really need, I want to take you out to some deeper places. We've got to go to the deep water to get it. Incidentally, if you don't know this, the type of fishing that Peter did was with nets. They were casting nets. And how this works is like this, is that you would take your casting net, and normally they're a circle, and you would take, they had weights, lead weights around the perimeter of the net's mouth, and the fisherman would gather up the net in his hands, and it would be all drooping down in the boat. He would take it, and then he would grab the cord and the cable, and he would grab the center of the net, and with great technique, these fishermen would throw nets. Sometimes these nets are better than 30 foot wide, and he would cast that net with just the flick of his wrist, and the net would spin, and the inertia of the weight on the perimeter of the net would cause the net to open up, and when it hit the water, it would be perfectly round, and then the net would sink. All the fish underneath it, the net would encapsulate, then the fisherman, with the technique of his wrist, he would pull the net's cord, the net would close up, and everything that was inside of it, they would bring it in. That's how they fished. That's the kind of nets that they have. And so they would cast that net out. Well, characteristically, at the Sea of Galilee, you didn't fish in deep water with those kind of nets. You fished in shallower water. So Jesus takes Peter and he says, hey, I want to fulfill your need. I'm going to take you to a place that's unlikely, where you're not expecting to have a catch. That's what he says. He says, I want to take you out to this deeper place because I want you to see something that's really cool. Now I want to bring to your attention, Peter and his companions, they fished all night. I want you to think about this. You're at work. You just pulled a 12-hour shift. You just got in a little extra overtime. You're exhausted. You've cleaned up all your tools. Your work area is clean, and you're ready to go home. You're already having dreams of being at home with your spouse, watching a little UFC, drinking a Diet Coke with your feet up. That may be me, but anyway, that you're dreaming of something, whatever you like. Just put that in your mind. You're finished working, and you're ready to go home. That's where Peter was when Jesus arrives on the scene. And Jesus interrupts Peter's exit strategy. And gets in his boat, takes him out there. Now Jesus goes one step further and he says, hey, Peter, I want you to take these nets that you've just cleaned up, that you've mended and fixed all the tears in and everything, and I want you to take them out, unpack them, and throw them in the water in a place that you don't usually catch fish in front of all these thousands of people, and I want you to try to catch a fish there. Peter's like, really? God, you don't, or Jesus, you don't really know about fishing, do you? Because see, at this point, you have to understand, Jesus, as far as Peter knows, is he's just a good rabbi. He's a great teacher, and he's a carpenter. What does a carpenter know about fishing? And Peter, I have no doubt, wants to put an argument, present an argument to Jesus and say, hey, you don't really know enough about fishing. You don't really know how to fish. So what I'd really rather you do is just teach from the front of the boat. It was a good teaching pastor. Good job. Now let's row the boat back in. And let's go home. Because all night, Peter's fished. And they've thrown that net out over and over and over. And you know, when the night probably first started, Peter and all of his buddies are kind of excited. They're like, this is going to be great. We're going to catch a lot of fish. You know how it is when you start to enter something? This is going to be the best vacation ever. I'll never forget. We went to Branson several years ago, and we were like, my whole family was stoked about it. We're like, it's going to be the best vacation ever. And my daughter got an infection in her leg, and then she doesn't take pills very well, which causes her to projectile vomit. And I'm going to tell you in just a few minutes, I won't give you all the details, but I'll tell you this much. We change all of the environment of Bass Pro Shop in Branson, Missouri with that recipe. And I won't go into it, but we built our own mountains we'll just leave it there. And all of a sudden, what we were excited about, it's going to be great, best vacation ever. And all of a sudden, it sinks in. It's not going to be the best vacation ever. It's going to be tough. It's going to be hard. Peter and his buddies, they set out that night to go fishing, and they're excited about what's going to happen. It's going to be the best night ever. And they throw the first time they throw the net. They pull it in, no fish. The second time, the fourth, the fifth, the 100th time. And maybe, I don't know when it happens. Maybe it's around midnight, maybe 1 o'clock in the morning. At some point, they throw that net, and they stop believing that there's ever going to be fish getting that net again. And Peter does what any good fisherman would do. He'd say, guys, let's move. Let's go somewhere else. We're not catching fish. And they move to somewhere else. And they try it there. And then they try it somewhere else. And they try some. And finally, the wee hours of the morning, they succumb to this reality. We're not catching any fish tonight. They're exhausted. It takes a lot of physical energy to throw these nets. These guys are like, man, let's call it a night. Let's go in. And they bring the boat into this port. Now think about this. All the other fishermen are standing up there. And guess what their question is? Did you catch anything, Peter? I don't want to talk about it. How many fish did y'all catch, Peter? I don't want to talk about it. It's embarrassing, right? So he has to live down all the making fun of him. Oh, you're a big fisherman, man. You did good today, Peter. Da, da, ha, ha, ha. Later that morning, Jesus has them take their boat out at the worst possible time in the worst possible place in front of all these people. Now you got to drop your nets again. Do you think Peter didn't want to argue with Jesus? You think he didn't want to go, hey, do you not understand? We're fishermen. We're experts at this. We're not going to catch any fish. Let's don't do it. Here's what he says. Listen to what he says. Master, Simon replied, we've worked hard all night and didn't catch a thing. Do you kind of hear his distrust that this is going to turn out good? You want to know why? Because in front of this huge crowd of people, we're going to throw these nets out. They're going to come up empty, and I'm going to have to deal with that again. Jesus, are you kidding me? Have you ever argued with God when he asked you to do something that you didn't want to do? I have. I'm a pastor. I do it regularly. There are times God asks me, he'll say, Scott, I need you to talk to this person. And there's times I'll go, God, I don't want to talk to that person. Now, I'm not talking about anybody in this service. It's the other service, one of the other services. But I don't want to. There's times I just want to go home. There's times I want to go do something I want to do. I don't really want to talk and get in. And there's times I will tell God, hey, God, this is not going to turn out good. I'm going to have that conversation, and I'll do it like you say. But here's the truth, God. It's not going to go good. They're not going to listen. They're going to get their little britches in a bunch. And the next thing you know, it's going to be a mess, God. And you know what? It's on you. You ever have those conversations with God? God's like a terrorist, though. He does not negotiate well. And it just happens like that. And there's times I'm like, I don't want to talk to them. I don't want to go through that. I don't want to tell them what they're not doing. They're going to be offended by it. They're going to be mad. Or I don't want to talk to that person. And are there times in your life where you think you're a bigger expert on what you need to do in your life than God? Peter thought he was a better fisherman. And you know what? Peter may have been a fisherman, but Jesus knew the fish. That's a distinct advantage. And Peter, I have no doubt, wanted to look at Jesus and say, hey, listen, Rabbi, I appreciate it. I bet you've got some good carpentry skills, and you're a great teacher, and you can put together an outline. Maybe you can even sing, but I'm the fisherman here. It's not going to work. I don't want to do it. But what Peter does next is pretty cool. Verse 5. But if you say so, Peter said, I'll let down the nets again. Does he sound enthusiastic? Does Peter say, man, that's right, Jesus, for you, I'm excited about letting my nets down? Is that what it sounds like to you? No. Peter's not excited about this. Here's a misconception in the church. We have this misconception in our church, or in any church, that if you're going to do something for God, you got to be excited about it. You ever heard that? If you're going to do it for God, you need to do it with all your heart. If you're going to do it for God, you got to do it with all your passion. If you're going to do it for God, you need to have a smile. You need to be a joyful this or that. Is that true? It is sometimes. But I'm going to tell you something. There are going to be times in your life, in my life, that God's going to ask you to do something that you're not going to be passionate about, you're not going to understand, or you're not going to even want to do it. That's just the reality. And sometimes you can't muster up this phony, yes, it's going to be great kind of deal. There's times that you just have to do it. Peter is not excited about doing what God asked him to do, but he's obedient. Now, before you get upset with me, because some of you say, well, you're supposed to be excited about doing the things of God. Are you really? Let's fast forward 2 years from this story. Jesus, God's son, is in a garden, and it's the night that he's betrayed, and it's the day before he's crucified. And he's in this garden, he's praying. He prays three different times, gets on his face, and he says, God, if it's possible, take this cup from me. I don't want to do this. If there's another way, let's figure it out, because I don't want to do this. This is not, I don't see Jesus in the garden going, yes, I was born to be crucified. I can't wait to go to the cross. It's what I've longed to do. He's not doing that. You know what he's doing? He's saying, Lord, let's figure out a different route. I don't want to do this. But he ends his prayer with something that all of us should carry with us. He ends it this way. He said, but nevertheless, not my will be done, but your will be done. That's how he ends his prayer. Can I tell you this? The mindset of obedience is greater than the heart of passion. There's going to come times you're not going to feel like doing what God wants you to do. The mindset of obedience is greater than the head knowledge of understanding. There's going to be times God's going to ask you to do something you won't understand. It's better to be obedient. Because see, in this circumstance, Peter didn't have to be all enthusiastic. He don't pull out his cell phone and call up Miss Peter and say, hey, warm up the grease. Get the hush puppies ready. I got Jesus in the boat with his fist going in the air. I got Jesus in the boat. We're about to have some fish, honey, coming your way. He doesn't have to be like that. All he has to be is obedient. If you would today make this conscious decision, God, whatever you ask me to do, I will do it. You would find God do and moving in your life in ways that you may have never seen before. All Peter had to do was say, yes, Lord. That's it. He didn't have to say, yes, Lord, I understand. Yes, Lord, I'm excited about it. Yes, Lord, I'm about to pee in my little fishing britches because I'm so excited about it. He doesn't have to say any of those things. All he has to say is, okay, Lord, I'll do it. And Luke chapter 5, verse 6 says this, and at this time their nets were so full of fish they began to tear. A shout for help brought their partners into the boat, and soon their boats were filled with fish on the verge of sinking. Here's what I love about this story. Here's what happens. So Peter gathers his net up. Maybe he's a little reluctant, like my kids are sometimes when I ask them to do something they don't want to do. And he's getting his net together, you know, kicking a couple of things. And he looks back at Jesus. I have no doubt he's like, Jesus, really, it's too late to be fishing. I'm kind of done with this. But he gathers it up, and Peter reluctantly takes that net, and in obedience, he throws it into the water. He maybe doesn't even put a good effort into it, but he just does what God told him to do. And there it is. He maybe don't even throw it very far. He normally throws them far, but it hits the water. And I have no doubt, maybe Peter's got the line in his hand, and he probably looks over his shoulder at Jesus, and he's probably waiting to see it. And I would dare say that when he looks back at Jesus, I think Jesus has this kind of expression. You know what it's like on Christmas? You know, on Christmas morning, when your kids have asked for a certain toy 153,000 times, and you've already told them 154,000 times, they're never going to get that because you wouldn't spend that much money on them. Not in 10 Christmases. You're not going to get it. You will never get the G.I. Joe with the Kung Fu grip. Not ever. You cannot ever going to get it. It's too much money. You can't have it. But you already know it's under the bed. Just not wrapped yet. And on Christmas morning, your kids are expecting, you know, plan B as they tear into the packaging, and you're sitting over there like a parent going, You're more excited than they are. And they open it up, and sure enough, there he is, Kung Fu grip and all. They're blown away. I have no doubt Jesus is in the back of the boat. He's watching Peter cast this net. And I have no doubt that Jesus is going, I can't wait till he sees this. And Peter, think about Peter's face. He goes to pull the string on this net that has been loose all night long, but then, bam. I bet he looked back at Jesus then too. Because all Peter can do at this point is hang on. He can't even bring him in the boat or his boat will sink. He has to call his buddies. They all come over. Everybody is blown away by all the fish that are in this net. This is unlike anything they've ever seen. They've never seen, as professional fishermen, not in a single catch have they ever seen this number of fish. Not only were they fishing in a place that fish shouldn't be, but they catch more fish than they've ever seen. Peter immediately knows that this isn't because Jesus is a good fish finder. Peter recognizes that this is because Jesus is the Lord of the fish and the Lord of the world and the Lord of his life. For the first time in Peter's life, he sees Jesus for who he really is. Not a great fish finder. He doesn't see him for that. Doesn't see him for a great rabbi, a great teacher. Doesn't see him for that. Doesn't see him as a multitude magnet who gathers people on the side of the shore. He finally sees Jesus as Lord. And I want you to know how he responds to it. I want you to look at that. Luke chapter 5, verse 8. Listen to how Simon Peter responds to Jesus. When Simon Peter realized what had happened, notice what he does. He fell to his knees before Jesus and he said, "Oh Lord, please leave me. I'm too much of a sinner." I don't know how many religious people you know. I know a lot of religious people. Unfortunately, kind of in the circle that I have to operate in, sometimes I have to run into a lot of religious people. I'm not really religious. I tell people all the time that, you know, I flew helicopters, I did photography, and God makes me preach. I love what I do, but it's not probably what I set out to do. But God called me to do it, so I get to do it, and I love it. But it makes me unique. I don't think of myself as a professional Christian. I don't never have really. I'm still surprised every week that God lets me speak into the lives of people. It's still a unique thing. But in my circle, there are religious people. And oftentimes I see religious people and they'll say things like this. They'll say, "Well, you know, I had this encounter with God and God said this to me, or God spoke this to me." And I always try to listen to what an encounter with God meant to them. And so often among religious people, it's crazy to me because it's unbiblical. I see that their encounter with God makes them almost arrogant and self-righteous. Have you ever noticed that? Someone who's met with God and I've got a word from God. You ever heard that? "I got a word from the Lord for you." Well, wouldn't the Lord just tell me? Why does he got to tell you? I mean, so was there my connection, bro? I mean, the Bible says that the Spirit of God lives in me. He could tell me, couldn't he? He can't go direct. But anyway, I've got a word for you. Here's what's funny, is that religious people, when they have an encounter with God, they kind of leave that encounter arrogant, looking down their nose at everybody else and trying to figure out what everybody else's sin is. But every other person in the Bible, when they have an encounter with God and they see him for who he is, they don't leave there more arrogant, they leave there more humble. See, what's interesting about this story is Peter is literally standing knee-deep in just a pool of silvery, slimy, stinky fish. They're knee-deep. And Peter's completely unaware of their smell when he sees the Lord and completely aware of his own stink. And Peter looks at the Lord and he says, "I'm not good enough to be in your presence." He didn't leave there more arrogant. He left there with a greater sense of who he really is. See, every time that I've had an experience with God, I didn't leave my experience with God coming in here ready to tell you guys how you better straighten your life up. Anytime that I've had an encounter with God, I left that circumstance understanding that I'm broken and I'm not what I'm supposed to be. And there's sin in my life that disqualifies me. And then I also leave there with this: God's grace is incredibly sweet. Because he loves me in spite of the fact that I am not everything that I should be. And I don't deserve the position that I'm in, but it's the position he's called me to. And I carry out what I'm supposed to carry out, not because I'm capable or able, but because he's called me to do it. And who he calls, he qualifies. And who he qualifies, he equips. And so it's a weird thing. That's exactly where Peter is. Peter tells Jesus, he says, "Get away from me," which is a request that Jesus won't honor. Because if I can tell you any one thing about Jesus, this is what I love. Jesus has climbed into more than one boat, more than one bar, more than one brothel to meet scoundrels like Peter and like me and like you. And each and every time when we become a self-confessed scoundrel and say, "Lord, we don't deserve to be in your presence. I'm not good enough to do." He says, "That's right and that's good, but I got a job for you." See, God recruits from the unlikely. It's funny that there are people that sometimes come on the scene, especially in Christianity, that already feel pre-qualified. Maybe they came from a preaching family, or maybe they came from some super holy parents, or maybe they memorized the Bible when they were young, or maybe they won the Bible drill when they were in sixth grade, or maybe they were the VBS Bible school queen or king or something else, and they feel qualified. God can use those people too. It just takes them a little bit longer, because at some point for them to really be used, they have to understand that they're not qualified or equipped either. But Peter, maybe like you and maybe like me, understood right off the bat when Jesus was in front of him, he was very well aware that he wasn't good enough. And Jesus said, "That's okay, right? But we're going to do something together. And it's going to be incredible. It's going to be amazing." When Simon Peter realized what had happened, he fell to his knees before Jesus and said, "Oh Lord, please leave me. I'm too much of a sinner to be around you." For he was awestruck by the number of fish that they had caught, as were the others with him. His partners, James and John, the sons of Zebedee, were also amazed. You know, it's a beautiful story, is that this story tells us that Jesus learned a lesson. I mean, Peter learned a lesson about Jesus. You know what he learned? That he's Lord. He learned it in a boat full of fish. Wow, Jesus is Lord. That's cool. And that'd be a great story. And what if that ended right there? Well, if that ended right there, some of you would have everything that you need today, but others of us needed this story to go on, because here's what's cool. Peter learned this story on this day, learned this truth on this day, only to forget it later. Have you ever learned something from God? He taught you a lesson that you forgot later? Has God ever taught you that, hey, don't get yourself in that circumstance again? And have you ever found yourself back in that circumstance again? And you go, I'm still an idiot. Such an idiot. You ever done that? Just me? Maybe. But Peter, that's where he's at. Peter's like, you know what? I recognize you as Lord. He's standing in a puddle of fish and he says, you're the Lord. I'm not good enough. You are God. You are in the flesh. You are incredible. Fast forward 2 years. 2 years from this point, Jesus is arrested. Peter's standing around a campfire and he curses the same Jesus that he just called Lord. More than that, a teenage girl comes up to him and he tells her, I don't even know that guy. I don't even know who you're talking about. Are you kidding me? I've never been with him. He denies him 3 times. That's what Peter does. And you know, the story could have ended there, couldn't it? That could have been the end of it. But that's not what happens. The next morning, Jesus is crucified and he dies on a cross. His broken body is placed in the tomb. And on the third day, that next Sunday, the very first Easter Sunday, Jesus is raised from the dead. Peter gets invited to go see the tomb that Jesus has been raised from. And Peter goes and he looks in and he knows this. Here's what Peter knows. Jesus has come back from the dead. And guess what Peter does? He goes back to the same Sea of Galilee that he first met Jesus. He gets back in the same boat that God called him out of. He goes back to throwing the same nets that he was throwing that day, and he goes back to fishing. And he just keeps fishing. One day, they're coming back in after having fished all night. They hadn't caught any fish this time either. And as he's coming in, there's somebody at the bank. He calls out, he says, hey, you guys caught any fish? Peter says, no. Don't you think Peter felt discouraged? He screwed up as a disciple. He's not making it as a fisherman. Everything's messed up in his life, no doubt about it. But that voice says, hey, have you caught any fish? I said, no. You know what the voice says next? Try the other side of the boat. Now, what difference would that make? But Peter and them, you know, desperate. When you're desperate, you'll try crazy things. So they go to the other side of the boat. Okay, whatever. They throw their nets out, and guess what happens? Bam! Just like before. And all of a sudden, they go to pull this net in, and the same thing that has happened only one other time in all of Peter's life. The net is so full of fish, it's beginning to tear. The boat is about to sink, and it takes Peter a fraction of a second to recognize the deja vu value of the moment and goes, wait a second. And he looks at the guy at the bank. You know what Peter does? He cannonballs off the front of the boat, and he swims as fast as he can all the way to the shore. You want to know why? Because Peter wanted to see face-to-face and be face-to-face to the one who duplicated a miracle so that he might know that not only had he come back from the dead, but he'd come back for him. Do you know that story? Do you know that Jesus did come back from the dead? Do you know that all that God has done throughout human history has in fact been for you? Did you know that? That almost sounds arrogant, but it's really not. Did you know that from the very beginning of time, where God called space, time, and matter, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and God called His Word into existence, and God called us into existence. He formed us from the dust of the ground. He breathed in our nostrils, and we became a living soul. From that point, to some 2,000 years ago, when Jesus gave His life for us on a cross, did you know that all of that, the creation of all things, setting the earth upon its axis, giving it this fragile ecosystem so that you and I could live in it, all of that was done for you. Did you know that? It was done for you. On the third day, Jesus got up from the dead. You know why He did that? For you. For you. See, Peter knew that Jesus had gotten up from the dead. He just didn't know He had done it for him. And for some of us, maybe we know the story of the Bible. Maybe we have some religious experience that we can tap into. Maybe we know that probably the stuff with Moses and Noah and all that stuff came to pass. But what you don't know is the most important truth that you can ever understand in life is the personal nature of the gospel is this. God did it for you. For you. I know pastors will say, hey man, don't tell people that. They'll become arrogant. No, how can you become arrogant? By receiving a love that you didn't earn and you don't deserve, but was given to you by a God who loves you more than you can ever imagine. Arrogance doesn't grow out of that. Security grows out of that. God did it for you. See, Peter knew that Jesus had done that. He'd come back from the dead, but not for him. Not until Jesus met him on the sides of the Sea of Galilee. And he puts fish in his net again. And he meets him there and he says, "Hey, listen, Peter. I know you think it's too late, but it's not. Try again. Try again." See, some of you came into this room today and you thought, "Man, I'm just going to share some experience with somebody." Maybe you're a visitor. Maybe you've been here a long time. You thought, "I'm going to share this experience with some other people. We're going to have a church experience and you're going to leave this place." But what you didn't know is that the knot that you're feeling in your throat, the pressure that you're feeling at this point, the conviction that you're feeling right now as I'm speaking to you and as God's speaking to you, you're beginning to recognize it as familiar. See, there was another time in your life where God spoke to you just as he's speaking to you today. And at that point in your life, you said yes to Jesus. And you said, "I'm going to follow you, Lord. I'm going to do what you ask me to do." And in a moment, you said yes. And in a moment, you moved into this relationship with God. But then life happened, didn't it? And you got off beat. And you did some stuff you shouldn't have done. And you feel disqualified. And, you know, you feel like that God doesn't love you. Listen to me. We talk all the time about God coming for us. And that's absolutely theologically accurate. And it's true. And it's biblically true. But have you ever stopped to think for a moment that God comes back for you? The first time on the Sea of Galilee, Jesus came for Peter. The second time on the Sea of Galilee, Jesus come back for Peter. See, today, some of you think, "Man, I'm done." You don't understand, Pastor. There's stuff I've done. You don't understand. I've messed this up. I knew better, but I did the wrong thing. And I there's no way. Listen to me. God's come back for you. That's what today's about. See, you might think that this message was for everybody in this room, but God made this tailor-made for you. Because he wants you to know that in the same way as he recreated a miracle for a fisherman that he called into ministry, that he's recreated this moment for you so that you might know that he's called you. See, you may have given up on God, but he didn't give up on you. You may have lost faith in him, but he didn't lose faith in you. God still has a calling for you. And you can resist it as much as you want, but today God comes before you and he presents before you two pathways. One will be your own. And the other will lead to life. And I believe without a doubt the Bible says choose life. Choose life. Peter got a second chance to live for Jesus. You know what's funny? From this point forward, Peter never fishes for fish ever again. But you know what he does for the rest of his life? He shares a message. And here's his message. Hey, it's not too late. Try again. Try again. It's not too late. Try again. And that's where some of you are. You say, "Well, Scott, you don't understand. I gave it a shot. I've tried. I tried sobriety." Listen, you know what Jesus is saying? Try again. "Scott, I gave it a shot. I tried to make our marriage better, but it didn't work out." Try again. "I tried to reconcile with my kids, and I've tried to have faith in God." Try again. God is saying, "Try again. Try again. Try again. Don't quit." If there's any one thing that Jesus has brought to the table for us that is infinitely more valuable than anything else, is the opportunity to try again. Move past your discouragement. He's invited you into a relationship with him that's personal, and he's asking you to try again. Try again. I know some of you are looking at, I see your face, some of you go, "Man, you don't understand, it's too late." Are you sure? You think it's too late? God doesn't believe in too late. He came back today for you. He delivered this message to you so that you might know it's not too late. Let's bow our heads together. And I want you just to, for a moment, inventory your own life. I don't want you to think about somebody else. I don't want you to try to figure out what's going on in somebody else's life or anything else. I want you to listen to what I'm going to have you ask yourself. I'm going to give you three questions to consider. For those of you who consider or believe that in your life right now it's too late, let me give you three things that you need to ask yourself. Number one is this. Think about this. Heads bowed. Nobody looking around. Number one. It's too late, Scott. It's too late. Is it? Well, let me ask you this. Have you given your boat to God? Have you given the platform that you're standing on where you find your security and your identity, have you given that to God? Because you can never know what God's going to do until you do that. Have you surrendered that to God? Let me give you a second thing. You think it's too late? All right. Maybe it is. But have you gone deep with God yet? Have you moved past the shallow solutions that you've considered and gone to the deeper solutions and deeper portions of God's provision? Let me ask you a third thing. Maybe you think it's too late. Have you tried the other side of the boat? Have you tried something different? You say, "Scott, it's too late." Listen to me. The reward of Peter's second effort wasn't a boat full of fish. The reward of his second effort wasn't all the fish that they caught. It was the God that he had a chance to see. See, for some of you, you're wanting a solution to a temporary problem in your life, but God wants to give you a glimpse of himself. It was after the great catch and the boat was full of fish that they come back to the bank and Jesus said, "Peter, come follow me," that Peter walked away even from the boat full of fish. What he thought he needed wasn't really what he needed. See, when God has the proper position in your life, the value that things should have, they will have. It's too late, Scott. Have you given God your boat? It's too late, Scott. Have you tried something different? Have you tried the other side of the boat? It's too late, Scott. Have you tried the deep waters that God's called you to? It's not too late. Try again. Try again. For those of you who are in this room that realize, wow, man, you know what? I need to try again. Or maybe for some of you, for the very first time, I need to give God my life. You understand that and you're experiencing that right now because God's spoken to you. If that's you, I want you to pray with me. Right there where you sat, you're going to pray a simple prayer. And you're going to commit your life to Christ. You're going to give God your identity. You're going to give him your influence. You're going to put him in the boat. You're going to put him in charge. You're going to give him control over you. And you're going to get a glimpse of the God that you've not seen before. If you're ready for that, why don't you pray with me? Just a simple prayer. Just something silent where you are. Just something like this. Just say this to God. Just silently, he'll hear what you have to say. Say, "Lord Jesus, I need you. I realize today that I'm desperate without you. And God, today I put my life in your hands. I don't know exactly what I need to do, but I know that you do. And Lord, I trust you. I believe that you died for me. You gave your life for me. That you were raised on the third day, just like what the Bible says. Lord, I pray that you will work through me. Thank you, God, for saving me and teaching me how to live. God, I offer this prayer. It's in Jesus' name. Amen." Let me pray for you. Lord, thank you so much for the opportunity for us to be here. Thank you for fishing boats, stinky fishermen, silvery, slimy fish, fishing nets, and so many things that you give us to help us understand how you interact with our lives. God, I pray that each one of us here might have indelibly imprinted into our mind that not only did you come for us, but you come back for us. Father, I pray that we might see you as Lord, a glimpse of you. I pray we might understand that it's not too late, that we can try again. Father, thank you for these things, Lord. Bless each person that's in this room. May we apply the things that you've taught us today. God, we offer this prayer. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you guys. We'll see y'all next week.